But first of all, I would like to congratulate the university with the 25th anniversary and be here to give that annual lecture. It was meant to be last month, but then the typhoon spoiled everything. But I'm happy that we could make it. And so far, I have had a great time. I heard about some very interesting science that's going on. And I think this place has a lot of potential. And I really look forward to seeing how it's going to develop in the next years. So what I will do is to talk about the work that Carl presented. But I will divide the talk in two parts. So first, I will try to be very general and just put it in a context. And then in the second part, I will present some of our more recent work that hasn't been published and see, try to show which direction we are going just now. But if we begin with the field as a whole, and with the field, I mean neuroscience, and especially what we call systems neuroscience, which is about trying to find out, discover the relationships between activity in neurons and the behavior that brain circuits are supposed to support. And that's not an easy task. And when I began as a student, then I told my supervisor that this is what I wanted to do, and he thought I was crazy. But now, 30 years later, it actually has become possible to relate the activity of the many billion, actually in humans, 80 to 100 billion neurons of the brain and the behavioral outputs. That's an immense task because if any of you are not neuroscientists, which I assume this is a quite general audience, so this is a cartoon of what it could look like in the brain. Of course, it's very simplified and astrocytes and glia are completely ignored, but anyway, it makes the point that there are many neurons and that they communicate via synaptic connections, neurotransmitters that pass the cleft and send signals over to cells, to the postsynaptic neuron. And this happens in each neuron among those 80 to 100 billion actually has about 10,000 connections to other cells. You can just then imagine how difficult it is to find the cells or the connections, synaptic connections that are involved in any given behavior. It is a large number, but still, compared to the total number, very small. So, and it's assumed to be distributed all over the brain. So to find these connections sounds just like an immensely difficult task. But still, there has been some progress, and I'll try to describe some of that. So I want to begin by walking 100 years back in time, more than 100 years. And to the early days of experimental psychology. Experimental psychology is where I come from myself, where I started my own studies. And experimental psychology has the first half of the previous century was quite dominated by an approach that was often referred to as behaviorism, which where psychologists, some of them shown here, some of the most famous ones, John Watson, Clark Hull, and B.F. Skinner, what they tried to do is to decompose behavior into its smallest elements, sometimes so small that they were heavily criticized for simplifying things. But nonetheless, this was a necessary approach where you, in all the complexity of behavior, tried to describe the smallest parts, which are often referred to as responses, and then their relationship to things that happen in the outside world, which are described as stimuli. And then in describing relationships between stimuli and responses, they were actually not only able to describe behavior, but also control it. And I'll show one example here. So this is a movie showing pigeons playing ping pong. And so, and it's simple because in this example, they just play the ball back and forth. And whenever the ball falls down on one side, as you will see very soon, then the other pigeon gets a reward. So now can pick up a reward there. And then they do it again. And then next time this one fails, and then there's a reward for the other one, and then you go back and forth, and in this way, Skinner could try, could get them to play ping pong. And I mean, this is the same as you can train a dog as well. You just provide the reward at the right time, and you can support almost any behavior. So, but as I mentioned, this dominated behaviorism or experimental psychology for many decades, but it was also criticized. And one of the criticisms was that you can't just describe behaviors as long chains of responses and their relationships to external stimuli. One of the scientists who made that point was Edward Tolman at UC Berkeley, who thought and proposed that behavior is actually can also be described by relationships between external stimuli in the world, and including spatial stimuli. So what he did that was the basis of his proposals is that he trained rats to walk in various kinds of mazes. One of them is shown here. It's a classic example. The rat starts here and then goes to a circle here and then walks through a tunnel to get to a goal in the end here, an open tunnel here. Does it many, many, many times and learns that if it walks through here, it gets to the goal and gets a food reward here. But then on a given test day, then suddenly there are many tunnels or arms open. And what Tolman found was that now when the rat gets here, it doesn't take the old path, which it would be up here, but actually takes the one that goes straight to the goal. And this sounds almost trivial, but it is actually not, because what it demonstrated was that that rats are able to take shortcuts when there's an advantage of doing so. And why is it important to take shortcuts? Well, that shows that behavior is not only the result of a chain of responses where one comes after the other, because if it had done, then it would just continue to do just the same as it had done before. So the fact that rats can take shortcuts and detours suggested to Tolman that we actually have internal maps of space, and that those maps can guide both us and the rats to the right location. And so this was the basis of what Tolman proposed as a cognitive map of the entire environment. So it's a spatial map, an internal map of the environment that both contains the spatial relationships but also contains information about what's special about each place in the environment. So, is there anything in the brain that would support such a map? And for a long, long time, experimental psychologists avoided this question, and they didn't want to talk about what was inside the brain. They treated the brain like a black box, really, and they described behavior as functions of input related to output. So input is the sensory stimuli, and output is the behavior. And there were many reasons for doing that. One is that they didn't have the right tools to record activity from neurons in the brain, and they also lacked concepts. But there were a few people who dared to break with this tradition. Two of them are shown here, Carl Lashley and Donald O. Hebb, and especially Hebb, who was Lashley's student, actually advanced or proposed a theoretical framework that is still in use for much of the neuroscience we are doing today. So he proposed how cells might interact to support the most complex behaviors like thoughts and memories. And he did not at that time have any experimental tools to really propose this, but the ideas were so groundbreaking that, first of all, they inspired many, many students then the next generation of students who went to the lab and actually were able to record the activity from neurons and see how neurons interacted to support behaviors like memories or plans or thoughts. So this was the beginning of emerge of psychology and biology. Or systems neuroscience. But then at the same time, many interesting things happened also in the field of physiology, and I'll just pull up one example, maybe one of the most important, which is in the field of sensory physiology. So at least two very important developments are shown here, both the work of Vernon Mountcastle, who described how neurons in the cortex were organized in relation to the sensory inputs in the somatosensory system, and David Jubel and Torsten Wiesel's work in the visual system. And the visual system is shown schematically here. This is a schematic from Feldman and Van Essen from the early 90s, which shows all of the areas of the primate brain that are related to vision, and then the relationship with lines between these boxes here. So essentially, it just shows the complexity of the visual system. But the point I want to make now is that the work of Jubel and Wiesel was at the real bottom of this hierarchy, near the thalamus and the retina, in an area called V1, where they recorded activity from individual neurons while animals were looking at different sensory stimuli, and then found that these neurons responded to particular features of the visual inputs. It could be lines or edges, and that those were the elements of the visual image that actually provoked activity in the neurons. So it was the first time, really, that they could match or relate activity in neurons to anything that was going on out in the external world. In the external sensory world of a conscious animal. So although this wasn't really what is classically described as psychology, it is the elements of perception, and in that sense was inspired also a lot of people who wanted to understand how neurons actually compute behaviors. And over the years, a lot of work was performed to understand how actually neurons in this area, V1, operate and how they support visual behaviors. But you can see that the visual system is a lot more, many, many areas, and those, of course, interconnect with many other areas of the cortex, too. And now, 50 years later, after Jubel and Wiesel's work, we're still not very knowledgeable about what's going on in each of these areas. So most of the knowledge is limited to the early stages here. But there are a few exceptions, and I'll talk about one of them today, which is actually at the peak of this hierarchy, namely in the hippocampus here and in the entorhinal cortex here. And that is maybe somewhat surprising, because one would expect that as inputs get in from the eye or from other senses at the bottom of this hierarchy, as you go further up, things get more and more combined, and signals get less and less distinct and would be more and more difficult to interpret them. But as you will very shortly see, as you get to the top here, you again get some signals that are very clearly related to something that goes on in the external world. And that's what I'm going to talk about now. And this is about the work of John O'Keefe, who in 1971 published the first paper where he showed that neurons in the hippocampus at the top of that hierarchy respond to one particular aspect of the external environment, namely the rat's location in the environment. So what he did was to record from neurons in the hippocampus, so electrodes, very thin electrodes in the hippocampus. So these are electrodes that nowadays are around 12 to 17 micrometers wide, so they're so thin that they actually stick in between the cells and can pick up the signals from the cells without damaging them, extracellularly outside the cells. And then these signals are led through cables, or can also be wireless, to a computer and then recorded as the rat is doing various things, for example, walking around in this box here. So I'll show you an example of such a cell that O'Keefe recorded in the early 90s. So this is, of course, from a later recording in our own lab, but it should illustrate the same concept. What you now see is a rat that is walking around in this box here, and it's walking around because we throw out small crumbles of chocolate, and the rats like that, and that keeps them running around for a long, long, long time. And then as they walk around in different places, we're recording activity from a single cell in the hippocampus, and so you will see the locations where the cell is active, and you will hear a sound each time the cell is active. So let me start the movie now. So one single cell in the hippocampus. So you hear the cell firing now. That's each time you hear a bop, it is an electric discharge of the cell. And you also see the locations where the cell is active. And what you probably already noticed is that this cell is active only when this rat is up in this left corner in a certain area up here. When the rat is down here, the cell is completely silent, but whenever it passes here, it fires an action potential. So this area where the cell is active was then called by O'Keefe, was called the place field of the cell, and he called the cells a place cell. Most cells in the hippocampus are actually like this. So they can be shown here in this color map, which shows the activity of the cell. So red is high activity, blue is low activity. This cell fires up here, but other cells may have other firing locations, may fire here, 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 anywhere. And collectively, the cells cover the entire environment. They each have their own firing locations. And because the cells collectively cover the environment, then O'Keefe, together with Lynn Neidell, some years later, in 1978, suggested that the hippocampus, or the places of the hippocampus, might be the implementation of the cognitive map that Tolman suggested a few decades earlier. So it's actually an internal map, and if you feed the outputs of these cells into a computer, the computer can instantaneously tell where the rat is based on the combination of cells that are active. So this was in the 1970s. And then many years passed, and I will not say so much about those. Much was learned about place cells, but still, when we started our own lab in Trondheim in 1996, then some of the major questions were still unresolved. And one of these major questions is, how does this place cell signal come about? Because this, as you remember from the schematic, this is really deep into the brain, very, very far from any of the sensory inputs or the outputs. So how can you so deep in the brain get a signal that is so clearly related to anything in the outside world? And as you all know, we don't have space sensors on our fingers or on our ears or whatever. So this spatial signal is created somehow in the brain. So how can this happen? And that was one of the questions that I thought was very interesting and which we followed up in our lab. So what we did was then to ask specifically in the hippocampus. So this is the hippocampus of a rodent brain. It looks like a sausage here. And this is a transection through the hippocampus, looks like this. And it shows the areas of the hippocampus. You have entorhinal cortex here, and then the sub-areas of the hippocampus, the dentate gyrus here, the CA3, and the CA1 here. And then the feedback is not shown, but goes back to entorhinal cortex. So CA1 is the last stage of a unidirectional circuit through the hippocampus. And it's in CA1, almost all places were recorded there for several decades. No one really went beyond that area. So the question was then, how is this place cell signal in CA1 area created? And one of the ideas that was around in the 1990s was that it was created in this loop here through the hippocampus. And what we tested then was, we asked, could it be that if the place cell signal is created in this earlier loop part of the hippocampal circuit, then if you remove this or inactivate this part of the loop, then you should lose the place cell signal here. So that's pretty obvious prediction. So that's what we try to do by inactivating or silencing activity in this area. So at that time, we didn't have dreads or optogenetics or anything. So we made a lesion here with ibotenic acid, which then removed this part of the circuit, CA3. And then we recorded activity back here in CA1 and place cells like this. So what you see again is the trace of the animal where the animal walked. And each red dot is the location where the cell was active. So we then asked, are there such place cells here when you block the activity in this earlier stage of the circuit? And this shows the result. So this was in 2002. And it shows that when we disconnected the circuit in this way, then actually still, by recording in the CA1 area, we have place cells.
They may be, perhaps not look so beautiful like the ones in control animals, but nonetheless show 7 different cells. Each of them have their quite distinct firing location in this box. So this cell, for example, fires in the upper right part, very clearly here, and is silent in the rest of the box. Same for the other cells. So that suggests that maybe the signal isn't created in this early part of here. So either this CA1 somehow creates it independently by itself, which for many reasons is quite unlikely, or perhaps there is something coming in from the outside, because there are also direct connections from entorhinal cortex into CA1. Those were really understudied at the same time, and they were not usually part of the diagrams of hippocampus. I had to draw it in myself. But that led us to go to entorhinal cortex and actually try to find out if there is any spatial activity there. So recording in entorhinal cortex, in the medial part of entorhinal cortex, is what we did. This shows a rat brain seen from behind. And here you have the entorhinal cortex in color. And the upper half here is the medial entorhinal cortex. And we put our electrodes into the very top here, which is, we call the dorsal medial entorhinal cortex, which is the area that has the strongest connections into CA1 area in the hippocampus where most of the place cells have been recorded before. And this is work that we did in collaboration with Menno Witter, who is a neuroanatomist and who had done work showing that it's actually here that the main connections are. So all the recordings earlier in this area had been in much deeper locations and people hadn't really found much spatial activity. So we went up here to the right spot and then started recording there. And this is what's now going to show a new movie to illustrate what activity looks like there. So again, you see a rat walking around chasing chocolate crumbles. And each time the cell, a single cell now in entorhinal cortex, is active, you see a white dot on the screen. So first of all, what you see is that this cell isn't really active at a single location like the CA1 cell in the hippocampus. It fires in many locations. And in that sense, perhaps one would conclude that this isn't really a spatially modulated cell. It fires everywhere, it seems. But as you look a little bit more closely, you will see that actually this is not random, because the cells are firing, this cell is firing in multiple locations. You see one spot here, one here, one there. And you'll also see that there's a certain pattern to these spots because they are kind of similar distance from each other. So we published this in 2004. It was clear that there was some regularity to it, but we didn't quite understand it. And it only became clear when we increased the size of the box that the rat was walking in so that we actually could see the pattern more clearly. And that is very clear in a recording from which we made some years later, which is shown here. This is a box that is 220 by 220 centimeters, so it's quite big, whereas this box, the standard one, is 1 by 1 meter. So much bigger, and the gray trace here shows where the rat walked during a period of 30 minutes, and each black dot shows a location where the cell was active, like the white dots in the movie. And what you can see now is that the cell is active in many locations, and you also see that those locations actually form a pattern, a kind of hexagonal pattern, where each field here is surrounded by 6 other fields at a 60-degree distance. You see that more clearly here. I try to help you here by showing a result from this box where a rat was walking, and you see the multiple locations here, and I put these red lines on top to illustrate that is actually triangular, or perhaps more correctly, a hexagonal pattern that surrounds each location and repeats itself all over the space. And this is like a grid, a triangular or hexagonal grid that is repeated all over the space, and for that reason we call these cells grid cells. And it's obvious that these cells contain a metric. They contain information about distances and directions, clearly. How this is used is still, to a large extent, a mystery, but the information is obviously there and provides a metric to the cognitive map that exists in the hippocampus. So then we asked, what are the cells like in this area? Are there many grid cells, and are they different in any way? And yes, they are different in some ways. So this shows an example of a recording from three grid cells that were recorded in the same location. I try to illustrate this in this schematic. You see these are the tetrodes, or the electrodes that stick into the entorhinal cortex. Of course, they look very big here, but they are only 17 micrometers wide. And the tip is uninsulated, so this is where the electrical activity is picked up. And then below you have cells, and then those cells, the electrical signals, action potentials from those cells are picked up by these cells here. In this case, we picked up signals from three cells and just illustrated them in three different colors. And you can see that the green, the blue, and the red ones are all grid cells, all have a grid pattern, but they are shifted in the X and the Y directions, so they have different phases, as we call it. So, and that is actually typical, because anywhere where you record in the entorhinal cortex, in the medial entorhinal cortex, you will find that there are grid cells, but the relationship between the phases of different grid cells seems to be quite random, not entirely random, but almost entirely random. And that means that at any given location in the entorhinal cortex, you have grid cells of different phases so that you cover all spaces. So you can see that even with those three cells here, you essentially cover the entire space. So that's a kind of random code, random, and in that sense, quite similar to what we call salt and pepper organization in some of the sensory systems. That just means that you mix them as much as you can. But that's very different from another level of organization, which relates to the scale of the grid cells. What is the distance between the fields, and the size of the fields, and how far are they apart? And this seems to be highly organized, because it's illustrated here. This is a rat brain, a sagittal section from the side. And this is the medial entorhinal cortex, the red part here. And it is organized such that when you start at the top here, the grids are very, very small. I mean, that means there's about 30 centimeters between each of the fields. And then as you go down in this brain area, the distance gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And as you approach the bottom, it may be several meters between each of the fields. So there's a clear topographical organization in the sense that the scale of the grid becomes bigger as you go from top to bottom in this brain area. So that then leads to the question, if there is such a gradient, is this a continuous gradient from small and then gradually getting bigger and bigger and bigger as you get down? Or are there actually different maps, each with a distinct scale, but more like in a step-like manner where you have a discrete number of maps that each have their own scale? So either is it continuous, gradual, or is it step-like? And to find out, what we did was that we tried to increase the number of cells recorded at the same time or in the same animal. And that's shown here. So what you have here on the x-axis is the position along the x on the length axis here from top to bottom. So that's shown on the x-axis here. Top is 0 and 50 is approximately in the middle. And then on the y-axis you have the size of the grid. That means the distance between the fields. And then each dot is one cell, and all of those cells are from the same animal. What you now see is that as you start from the top, you see that most of the grid cells have a small scale, approximately 40 centimeters between the fields. And as you go down, the scale increases, yes, as we knew from before. But what you also see is that the increase is actually step-like. There's nothing between, and then you get up to the second level, approximately here. And then you retain some cells from the first level. Then you get to the third level here, but you retain the second. And then you get to the fourth level here, but you also retain each of the previous ones. So you add, as you go down from top to bottom, you add new steps to the map. So if it is a step-like increase, then we can ask, how is this organized? So if you call these steps M1, module 1, module 2, module 3, and module 4. We can ask, what is the scale relationship between those modules? And we address that question by simply dividing the scale of neighboring modules. So M2 divided by M1, M3 divided by M2, and M4 divided by M3. And what he found was that there's actually a constant scale increase, so that if the scale of module 1 is 40 centimeters, you multiply by a certain factor and you get M2, and then you multiply M2 by the same factor and you get M3, and then you multiply M3 by the same factor and get M4. And that factor in our hands is approximately 1.4, or on average 1.42. So that there is actually a constant scale ratio, and this is exactly like in a geometric progression where you simply multiply by the same factor to get the next level. And of course, that raises questions, why is the brain so organized? What's the advantage of having a geometric progression in the relationship between modules or grid cells? That's, of course, not entirely clear yet, but this has been triggered the interest of many physicists, theoretical physicists, and what has been suggested is that by organizing the grid map in this way, it's actually the most efficient way to represent space in a detailed manner with a minimum number of neurons. So that's perhaps there is a reason for that it has evolved that way. So I will just then add in the end of this general introduction that there are not only grid cells in the entorhinal cortex, also many other types of cells. One of the most important, shown here, is called head direction cells. And those cells were actually discovered already in 1985 by Jim Rank in New York. And what he found was that in a neighboring region, not in the entorhinal cortex, but in what's called the presubiculum, cells are not spatially modulated, not grid-like like we saw, but they have a directional firing, and that's shown here. So what this plot shows is the firing rate of a particular cell as a function of the direction that the head is pointing. So when the rat's head is pointing from left to right, shown in this axis, no firing. But when it's pointing from right to left, so when the rat is walking from right to left in the box, then there's high firing. And this is the same on two different trials. This is another cell. This cell only fires when the rat is walking from the bottom right towards the top left. Then the cell is very active on two different occasions. So these direction cells, they're kind of an internal compass in contrast to the grid map, which is more like a coordinate system. And in addition to that, there's even more. In 2008, we also found yet another type of cell, namely what we call border cells, which also existed in the entorhinal cortex. And these cells, as you can see here, they fire only along the borders of the environment. So this is, again, a box like the one you saw. Color indicates the firing rate, and you can see that the cell fires only, this cell fires only when the rat is along the west, the east wall here. And it happens even if you stretch the box, still fires along the east wall. And even if you stretch it in the other direction, it still fires along the east wall. And this plot shows what happens when you put the cell into a different box in a different room. Now it chooses randomly another location, namely the west wall. And then when we insert a wall, like here, put a wall in the middle here, then it also fires along that wall, but again on the same side as on the peripheral wall. So these are cells that only care about the local borders. It could be walls, it could be edges of a table, and they kind of define the local boundaries of the environment. And then yet another type of cell, found yet another type of cell in the same circuit more recently, in 2015. And those are cells that, as you can see here from the color plots, they don't really fire in a certain location of the box. This shows for 12 cells firing in different locations, 12 cells that all fire in many locations of the box. But what you should notice here is the plot to the right, which shows firing rate on the y-axis as a function of the speed of the animal on the x-axis. And what you can see for all of these cells, which fire more or less all over the environment, is that the firing rate increases more or less linearly with the speed of the animal. So the faster the rat is running, the faster the cell is spiking. There are many of these cells, as you can see, and you can even see some example here. Can you still hear me? Yeah, okay. Seven different cells, each in a different color, and superimposed on a plot of the speed of the animal. So the speed is shown in gray, and then the color shows the firing rate of the cell. And you can see that for each of those cells, the firing rate actually matches the speed closely. So these are cells that clearly read out the speed of the animal. And of course, this is very useful information for the grid cells, because if you have input about the current speed and about the current direction from the head direction cells, then you have essentially what you need to construct on the fly a map of the rat's location at any given time, because you can use your own movement as you're walking around in the environment to actually infer how much you have moved from the previous location, both in speed and in direction. So what we have here now is a map of different cells. You have the grid cells, which is more like a coordinate system. You have the head direction cells, which provide the direction. You have speed cells that tell about how fast you move from one direction to another. And finally, you have the border cells, which provide information about all local boundaries. And all of this is put together and then used by this circuit to somehow indicate where the rat is at any given time. And presumably, this helps the rat to find its way in the environment. But this is not only about rats. So not surprisingly, we found exactly the same in mice. But more interestingly, perhaps, this shows an evolutionary tree for mammals. So a few years later, grid cells were also found in bats. Bats are not small rats and they're not small mice. They're actually on their own branch of the mammalian evolutionary tree. And the grid-like cells with somewhat different properties were found in monkeys and also in humans more recently. So that this seems to exist all over the mammalian evolutionary tree. And it's probably something that evolved quite early, at least in mammalian evolution.